Ladies and gentlemen, yes. Welcome to Musicians Having Coffee and Talking About Stuff. The illustrious Ted Leonard with us today. That's very nice. Ted's Hallmark Christmas movie.
My wife got a kick out of over the Christmas season of how many of those movies I watched. You know, I would like binge on the Hallmark channel. I know I seem gruff and
right. That's funny, dude.
My exterior is so masculine, but I would turn those on and she would just watch me like her prey, like white waiting for me to cry. You're going to cry, aren't you? Big sissy girl. So for Christmas, she got me this cup and then like socks that on the bottom of them, if you can see this, you know, on the bottom of the sock, it says, if you can see this, I'm watching Hallmark Channel. It's really pathetic.
Wow. Honestly. That is pretty sad, I must say.
She gets off on emasculating me.
Well, I've been known to watch Hallmark.
I must enjoy it a little bit too because I'm advertising it myself. So
I've been known to watch a Hallmark movie or two every now and again. Some of them are just terrible. Some of them are actually okay and pretty good, you know?
Yeah, like, they're all terrible. They're all exactly the same.
Well, I don't know. There was one, I can't believe we're discussing this, but there's one called Window Wonderland that I thought was pretty good. Like it was, it was kind of a cute little rom-com. It wasn't exactly the same as, you know, all of them. So, I mean, I even know names of them, Ted. So
I didn't remember any names. I just hope I'm making you feel better. The premise is, you know, a really cute girl who's slightly thick once she gets below the waist. And either that or I think the aspect ratio on my TV with that channel was wrong because they all looked wide. But I was always such, it was always such a positive story. It's like, hey, pudgy girls can find love. That's beautiful.
Man, you're going to get in trouble. Like some older actress that, you know, like used to be like a star on a TV show in the 80s or something. And now, the fun thing is to figure out like, and it's so obvious. Like, okay, there's the love interest guy. That's got to be the love interest guy. We're not sure yet. They don't like each other at first, Ted.
It's conflict.
Right. Conflict and resolution.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. They're usually in some bad relationship already with some dank guy. You know,
right.
Somebody.
It's not Lifetime, so nobody's getting hit. But if it was Lifetime, the girl would be getting hit by whoever she's with.
Oh, is that the distinction?
Yeah, I think that's the distinction. It's like Lifetime television for women who
are really.
Horrible. Anyway, I'm getting all sorts of trouble today already.
This is rough. Well, it's musicians talking about stuff, so we can talk about anything.
This is stuff indeed.
Yes.
Yeah, so this is my, I live in New York now, and this is my studio. It looks a little bit more like a studio than my last place that you made fun of on our last conversation.
That's right.
I've done a lot with it. But, I've got all my guitars hung up, so that's cool.
Yeah, that's cool, man.
This is my favorite right now, though. I had to show this one. I bought this for my daughter. And it's like, it's one of those like little tiny ones.
Yeah.
It's like the best sounding Strat I've ever owned. It's so cool. It's like 3/4 size. Like, hey, fat guy in a little jacket kind of thing. I love it. I'm totally going to record some on the next Pattern Seeking Animals album with this thing for sure. It's like my favorite sounding Strat, and it's one of those Squires that you buy 3/4 size for kids.
Wow.
And I love it. So anyway, that's my favorite right now.
Sometimes the cheap things are cool, actually.
Yeah.
You know, some of my favorite instruments have not been the most expensive ones, but.
Well, what about your Strat? What's the story behind that? Was that expensive?
Not for me. It was a gift. At the time, my brother Richard was buying and selling stuff out of the recycler in LA, which was like the used music gear paper.
We had something similar in the Bay Area.
Yeah. And he would go there like super early on Thursdays, I think it was. That's when it came out. and he would get the paper like, you know, before it came out or something. If you went to the offices, you could get, and he'd go and scour it and get all the killer deals. So he got the Strat for a girlfriend of mine to give to me on my birthday in the 80s sometime for, I think, $150.
Wow. Yeah. That's like a 70 Strat or what?
Yeah, I think it's a 76 or 78.
That's a big headstock on it, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It only has three, for, you know, the real guitar nerds out there, it only has three bolts in the neck. So it's easier easier to throw out a tune than the ones that have four. But it's home. You know, I played it, you know, from that day forward in the clubs. And all
you have
that,
some sort of humidity control in your studio to keep your instruments from getting all wacky?
No.
See, that's the thing that I've found out, because my office like backs up to, you know, open space. I have all these big windows. It's beautiful.
Oh, that's really nice, man.
Yeah. So it backs up to all this open space, but, you know, because it's the big windows, all the humidity gets in. And I've just noticed, like, you know, the blonde Strat up there, it's completely fretting out now. The neck is bowed. And in the move, I lost all my little adjustment tools, so I got to go find an Allen wrench. But that's why everybody's big on the roasted maple necks now, because apparently they stand up to humidity. We Californians never knew that was a thing.
I still don't. I haven't really thought about it. I've only noticed it with my piano in the other room.
Oh yeah.
The guy who tuned it said, "Oh, you need to put a dehumidifier by this," which of course I didn't actually do. But my Strat, the distress on it is stuff that I inflicted on it.
Right.
Like, when I got it, it looked regular. Like, I actually rubbed like the way it's all like open wood at the top. That's from me playing like AC/DC songs five nights a week in clubs in LA.
That's the best kind. I mean, I remember when I first got the black one you see there, that's a Tom Anderson. Those are expensive. That was like $3,400. And I remember I was so careful with it. And now it's just beat to hell. If you look close, it looks fine from about 3 feet away. But if you look close, it's just nicked. And,
yeah,
because, you know, again, because of cover band gigs, you know, but, you know, even when you go on tour, there's been times where, you know, I've never brought that one on a tour. The only time I've played that in front of progressive rock audience was when I sat in for Roina on the ship.
No kidding.
That was the only time I got to play a guitar I actually like, because usually when I play with Transatlantic, I need to switch back and forth between acoustic and electric really quick. So I use that Line 6 kind of looks like a Les Paul guitar.
Right.
Which I, you know, it's fine, but it's not like my baby, you know?
Right. Yeah.
It was so cool to do that gig on the boat and be able to pull out a guitar I actually enjoy playing, you know?
Yeah.
For once.
It's hard to find a guitar that's your baby, isn't it? It's like, I've tried to take other guitars and I always wind up just, I don't know, man, just string up the Strat, you know? As far as playing, especially for playing live, like, I love to play the 335 in the studio, but I'm still not really comfortable with it live for some reason.
Right.
Like, there's a...
No, I know. There are some guitars that are great for the studio because they make you fight harder to get something out of them, you know, but then...
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, but with the 335, I love the tones and stuff, but it's so big, you know, and there's this feeling in my mind, I think, that it's fragile. And I don't like to feel, I like with the Strat, like, I've been playing it hard for so long. Like, I'm not worried about it at all.
Right.
You know?
Maybe
I should.
Well, I know a lot of people will have especially on bass. I think even Dave's talked about it. He's got basses that have higher action. His action is always high for my taste anyway.
Mm.
Dave Merrows, for those who don't know. But he enjoys like a bass that has bad action because it kind of handcuffs you during the recording process, makes you maybe simplify your part for one song or something like that.
Whereas really?
if the guitar, if you put nines on and it's just so, you know, easy to play, then you're just going to noodle too much or something like that.
Really?
It's a theory.
I do like to have some meat, you know, if the action's too close, I don't know. I don't feel that. And it's just weird. It's probably a lot of what you're used to, you know.
I think if your hands are anything like Al's, and they probably are, I heard, and you guys probably share some DNA in there. His fingers are so strong. I mean, it doesn't matter what guitar he picks up. You know, when I watch his left hand, it just doesn't matter. He can pick up an acoustic and he can solo like it's an electric nearly. If he had a sustainer pedal, that's what it would sound like.
Yeah.
But he's just so strong. Like for me, single note stuff on an acoustic, like you do, it probably makes sense why you're so good at soloing on an acoustic if guitars don't throw you off, because your fingers are just that strong. So if an acoustic doesn't slow you down, then a 335 isn't going to slow you down. You know.
Anyway. Yeah, no, the 335 is really cool. That's a Gibson, by the way, for those that don't know. But anyway, tell me about speaking of transatlantic, because we haven't determined whether you're for sure going to be the fifth guy, right? There was those emails with, I haven't heard back yet. So
yeah,
what do you think?
Well, I think it's, I think it's logistically fine, and because the Canadian gig's also on the East Coast, I think, it's only, the flights I looked up were only like 6 hours. So if I get out of there, at 12 o'clock, I'll be there in plenty of, or if I get out there in the morning, I'll be there in plenty of time for sound check and everything.
Yeah.
The next day. So I really want to do it for a number of reasons. I don't know how many more tours Spock is going to do, or Enchant, and, Pattern Seeking Animals is, I don't foresee that ever being a big thing. This, I get this like sneaking suspicion that this might be like the last big cool thing I get to do, and my work is so busy right now, to take more than 3 weeks off would be questionable anyway.
Well, the question is, I think the question in the emails is about the rehearsal schedule. Like, will you be able to, because pretty much once the transatlantic, except for that one day, once the transatlantic ship goes, you'll have to be all totally ready to do those Pattern Seeking Animal gigs. Basically, what's going on, everybody, is so we've got this transatlantic live schedule that by the time this airs, I guess would be the right word, that will already be announced. So we can talk about it. But Ted also has some Pattern Seeking Animals gigs during that same time. Like on the ship, you'll have to make sure that everything's cool on the ship too. You know what I mean?
Right, I guess Jimmy's in three different things on the ship too. So that luckily we don't have to deal with his schedule, but that's always the case. I don't know how they do it. They've always had to juggle things. The first time I was on a cruise with Transatlantic and Spock's, second time was Spock's and Enchant, third time was Spock's and Enchant. And then, I've only had one cruise where it was just Spock's.
Right.
And Enchant wasn't on there, or Transatlantic wasn't on there. And I think that was the last one. And then I still jumped up and played with you guys. So I still, there's still rehearsals to run to.
Yeah.
That's kind of the beauty of it, I think. The cruises are so fun that way, getting to play with other people. And
oh, yeah. Yeah. I've only done one where I only had one gig, the two shows to do. There's always tons of other stuff. And then people come up and like, hey, would you guest with me? We're going to rehearse in my room on your only day that you could go to the beach.
Right. The wives love it when that happens.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. My no poor complaints. Wife was like, totally abandoned the first. Yeah. And on the first, I remember the first cruise we did, you also had the Sunday morning service that you had to do, and not had to do, but
you were
running around like crazy. And that was the same cruise where we recorded in the theater, the Spock Spirit Show, with you coming in playing The Light and I think Go the Way You Go, two songs. I'm not sure. No, The Light and June, I think.
June, yeah.
And then we had to, my keyboard rig, we had to get that on a thing and run to the pool stage for Transatlantic.
Yeah.
I just get it all plugged in. It was like, we had like a 20-minute window there.
That was so funny, because they were like, there was big arguments that had gone on. I don't know if you were aware, but there was big arguments with the planners of that cruise. you know, because they knew that, oh, Neil's going to guess, you know, with Spock's, and Ted's doing Spock's. And then, so like it was, you know, Spock's ended at 10:45 and this pool stage show was supposed to start at 11 or something. So, but for whatever reason, they decided that was the way it needed to be. And, but then it was going to be like, okay, we're going to, Neil, we're going to have a guy there and he's going to take you below the ship. Like, and he did, he took me like all the way down. There's like something they call like Main Street or something, that down in the catacombs of those ships.
That's where like Leonardo DiCaprio's character would be hanging out.
Lower than that. Yeah, it was really weird. It's like where they're all working, but it's all completely open and you can walk like from one end of the ship to another without any obstructions. Yeah, it was pretty interesting. But it was also like what they were, I think they were trying to, you know, whisk me away like a big star and keep me, you know, like we'll take you right up to the stage. And anyway, so we got down there, we walk across and we come up, and then it's like, okay, now we got to get in the elevator and go up to the pool stage, right? So we get in the elevator with all the people, you know, full of people that were just at the show, like, oh, hey, Neil, how's it going? Yeah, okay, good. Yeah, I'm trying to get up to the pool stage. So yeah, okay. It was just funny.
The worst is the crowded elevators when you've just jumped off stage. I mean, I don't know if you're like me, but I sweat so much when I'm on stage. I'm just a sweater, you know. And so I get on there and people are like, hey, man, they'll pat you on the back. They'll be like,
So people like, go. Sometimes people will go to hug me, and I'm like, "Oh, you don't want to do that."
It's
oh,
just gush.
Yeah.
It's just There's been many of those.
So you're doing it.
I want to do it.
So we want you to do it. So Ted Leonard, ladies and gentlemen, is the fifth guy for the upcoming transatlantic gigs in 2022.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I got to figure out something to not have to use that Line 6 guitar, though. I got to figure out something.
Well, I'm sure that's you can figure it out.
To be able to, well, even one of those stands like that, you know, that has the acoustic, like Al has, you know, will probably do the trick. You know, I just need to get one of those.
Oh, yeah. I have one. I own one of those stands for MorseFest.
Oh yeah,
they're actually pretty expensive. What do they call lavalier stands or something? They have they have a fancy name.
Yeah, I got to get one anyway because I'm so tired of that simulated acoustic sound. I mean, it's great. It sounds pretty convincing when you're like finger picking or playing soft, but as soon as you start strumming, it's horrible. And if you have the 12 string sound on, there's a little bit of latency.
Oh wow!
So when we were doing, I can't remember what song it was, but I remember when we did a live video, I had to replace all my 12 string strummy parts because I was like just far enough behind to where it was just not grooving at all, you know?
Oh, wow.
So
yeah, anyway,
the fun, the techie stuff.
Yeah. The gear stuff. Yeah. But you know, I was talking about being on the cruise. You got any funny stories of mishaps and things? I mean, cause it's pretty crazy up there sometimes. You know,
that I can share.
Yeah, things that you can share, right?
There's been moments. Well, actually, you know, I think it was one of the first cruises. Was hanging out with Tiffany and Nick, and we went and did karaoke at the end of the night. The one of the cruises they had karaoke every night.
Dude, that is legendary.
So we first of all, Tiffany's a hoot, as everybody knows, you know, and I love Nick. And we were just hanging out. I think we were just having drinks or whatever. And we were like, let's go up to karaoke and we're going to pick songs. You know, I'm kind of confusing the story as the time when I was hanging out with Eric and his wife, Eric Gillette and his wife.
Oh, yeah, that was another one. Yeah.
That was another time. But this time was really funny too, because I put forth the same premise. It's like, we're going to go up there, we're going to sing the thing that we think would be, you know, what prog fans would want to hear least. And so he got up and I think he did some Tony Orlando or, you know, Neil Diamond song, which Neil Diamond, you know, that's universal. That works. That's not really going with the rules. I got up and did an Eminem tune and Lose Yourself, you know. His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy, his vomit on a sweater already, mom's spaghetti, he's nervous, you know, all that. And
Oh yeah, so, sure. I know every word, man.
Yeah, I totally don't know though. But you know, people are going, what? I had a hoodie on too, and I was like, you know, yeah, it was funny. And then I did a song by Usher called Yeah, Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You know that one.
Oh yeah, my kids love that song.
So, well, my wife and I still do the cover band thing.
Oh, are you still doing that? Are you doing it in New York now?
We were going to, and we, you know, we still might, but some things have transpired that might, you know, cut into that a little bit, because we went to guest lead at a little church start. You know, a complete, there was like 40 people at this church, you know. And we didn't know it was a working audition. We just were guest leading because their normal worship leader was out of town. So we brought in, you know, and I'd been to that church a couple times, and you know, the person led from keyboards, and she, you know, sings very, you know, kind of thing, kind of old school.
Yeah.
And we went in there with our, you know, big bombastic modern worship. And then we found out that girl had put in her notice a couple of weeks before. And so anyway, we're going to be taking that over. Apparently that just came about as a Monday. After,
well, that's really cool, man. What city is that in case anybody wants to go?
Victor, New York. So we're in Canandaigua, which is near one of the Finger Lakes, by that name. And Victor is a town just to the side of it. And it's kind of near Rochester.
Okay.
So we're hoping to pull some talent from Rochester. This doesn't need to be in the shot.
Do they have talent in Rochester? Do they?
They do.
Really?
Well, New York, you know, it has some. However, when you get to the outskirts, like where I am, the talent pool becomes very shallow.
Yes. But you have filled it dramatically, no doubt. You and your wife.
Overflowing.
Yes. Well, that's really cool, man. I'm glad to hear that. Yeah.
It'll be interesting. I mean, I've got to, like, so now I've got to, like, pull together, you know, planning center and charts, and we don't have a keyboardist. So I've got my keyboard out. I want to be able to lead from keyboards every once in a while. You know, there's certain songs where, and it's just so much, because usually I'm leading from electric. And the biggest hole in the sound when you do that is, like, when someone's talking and you want to just have a little ambiance behind them.
Mm-hmm.
Electric doesn't really... I mean, it can, but it doesn't really do the trick like an acoustic or just like a nice little pad or something, you know?
Yeah, you need that. So, yeah. My favorite new worship stuff is, I think it's called Maverick City. Or have you heard any of that stuff?
I think so.
Look up You Hold It All Together and Refiner. They're both really, really good.
My favorite right now is Elevation, that song Rattle.
Yeah, yeah, that's great.
We just did Rattle on Sunday, and that's just like, it's just, you know, it's big rock.
Yeah, so you hear the bones are rattling. Yeah,
that's so funny how, like, we're losing our audience entirely right now, but right. it's so funny how
there might be two. There's probably two guys going, oh, they're talking about worship, all right.
Yeah, there's like so many songs with dry bones in it right now. It's like this thing right now.
Well, I love Lauren Daigle's. That was her first come out thing, wasn't it? Dry Bones. You call out to Dry Bones, come alive, come alive.
I gotta look that one up.
Oh, it's great. Yeah, we call out to dead hearts, come alive. Yeah, that was her first
one. You're serenading me right now.
I'm getting all into it, man. Yeah. I love a good worship song. I mean, I'd like to hear more controversial fifth chords. You remember that joke? Like that was on the Onion or the Babylon Bee or something like that. It was like they showed all these protesters outside of church, and it said, you know, protest breaks out as Hillsong introduces controversial fifth chord.
I know, right? It's so funny. I mean, it's like, it is so true. Every song, well, it's still U2 and Coldplay. If you
consider
Coldplay derivative of U2,
yeah,
it's like it's amazing to me that
so much mileage.
I know, it hasn't progressed, and the guitar players are still going dick, 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 with the delay tricks, and it's all, you know, and way too much reverb, and you know, it seems to be more about the sound than it is you know, the actual part. But there are some cool stuff out there too, even with that in mind.
Oh yeah, yeah, there is. And there was another Babylon Bee that I really liked. It had this picture of a guitar pedal board with about a zillion pedals, and it said, pedals on worship leader's pedal board outnumber chords used 2-1.
That always is the case. If you have more than four, then yeah, that's always the case. I use the Helix. It's just, you know, that's kind of like the go-to if you don't want to have a big crazy board.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Or that like the Fractal or the Limper? Yeah,
it's the Line 6 version of the Fractal. It's this guy right here.
Yeah.
You know, but it's the Fractal's cooler for those people who want to spend way too much money. And Eric. And Eric uses a Fractal, right? Don't you have a Fractal now?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's I don't use it at church. I don't use it in the studio either. I used it a little bit on Solo Gratia, but I don't know. I just don't feel it. I like pedals, but I just feel pedals better. Yeah. I like being able to I don't want to program. I can't program everything I'm going to want to use. And I don't know. I'm just funny.
No, I feel you there, but like the number, if you're going after, you know, the sounds that they are using these days,
yeah.
Then I mean, like you almost have to have like some, because otherwise you're going to have to own like three different kinds of reverb pedals,
right?
Three different kinds of delay. And no, I don't want to do that.
So right. Yeah, sure.
If I'm going to spend my money, it's going to always be on an overdrive pedal. That's why I have this box full of overdrive pedals at all times.
I have a lot of them too. I got a lot of them too. I got the, what do you got? I got my favorite's the Mesa overdrive. I forget what it's called, but that's a really good one. I still have my Metal Zone. You got Metal Zone?
Really?
Yeah.
I don't have a Metal Zone. Never liked that. Oh, but I always use a twin.
It's horrible, but it's really great for if you just want to do some horrible, like really gnarly sound, like thing,
right,
that just comes in, you know. It's great for that. I remember doing the solo there in Time Has Come spot on the Beware of Darkness album. I liked my solo from the demo so much through the Metal Zone that it's in one side and Al's in the other side. We used them both.
Oh, that's true.
Because I just got some insane stuff. And I remember Sherry's grandma was still alive and living with us at the time. And I was recording in the attic. And I think she called Sherry and she said, is the guitar going to be on all day? Because I was just going, aah! It was just like insane feedback. And, you know, and then I would just like record just a little 2-second piece of this and use it, you know. But yeah, Metal Zone's actually useful.
Yeah, I've got just so many overdrive pedals. My favorites right now are the good old Chandler tube driver, which is actually it's one of those big pedals that's that, you know, like David Gilmour would use. It's fairly large. This is the Lucasin Bubble Wraps that I just moved. But it's this big. It's this one.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Eric Johnson, David Gilmour. It's just, and this isn't actually the Chandler. This is the one made by the guy himself, BK Butler. But, and when I actually called him and talked to him. I'm like, oh man, yeah, the Chandler tube driver was one of my favorites. And that was like saying the wrong thing to him because they took over his design and they changed the frequencies a little bit and it was more mid focused. And he goes, yeah, they ruined it. So I bought this one for way too much money. And then, because my Chandler was like in disrepair for like 20 years, and but I finally got the Chandler fixed, and I put him side by side. And I'm like, sorry, BK Butler, the Chandler guy's got it right, because that's still, you know, it's still my favorite.
Oh man, and I'm telling.
It just adds something. It kind of sucked.
I'm telling.
But anyway, yeah. No, I don't think he'll be watching this.
Hey, I wanted to tell a funny story. The story I think is funny, anyway. I was back. I'm back on being on the cruise, and crazy stuff happening. Okay, so last time I played on the pool stage was with Flying Colors. I think it was like Mike's birthday, and he was doing like a little bit of, you know, everything from his career. And I think that's what it was. But Todd was, you know Todd, my friend. Yeah, you know Todd? My friend Todd. Anyway,
that guy owes me $50.
Right. He was my tech, and it was just hilarious. They took forever to get, you know, when you're waiting backstage and you're late and you're waiting for all the crew guys to come down and say, yeah, you're ready. Everything's ready. You know, that you're basically waiting for them to tell you all your equipment's ready and my headset and everything. And so they finally, it's like 45 minutes late, and they finally do that. And we go up, and the first thing that I'm like, hey, did you make sure that the Leslie's working? Did you make sure that, you know, did you check all my stuff? You know, I always just drill who's ever, are the pedals taped down? There's all the stuff that I need to make sure. Yeah. And so I get up there, and the first thing that happens is I notice that this computer actually that I'm looking at right now is the same computer, and it's closed. The computer is closed.
The main stage is asleep.
Yeah, and it won't just wake back up. I know from experience, you can't just open it up and it work. It you have to restart.
Right.
So
do you need to restart your computer or just restart main stage?
I think you need to restart the computer, and it's kind of a little bit older and doesn't go like super fast. So that's right. That's the first, like, oh my God. And so the gig's starting, right? And I'm like, and I've got a headset on, so I can't really yell. I'm like, Todd! I'm trying to pull it up. I'm trying to get his attention. So he finally comes up, and I've got the organ to play, and the Leslie is not hooked up correctly.
Oh, man.
But anyway, I'm starting to play. It's the beginning of Blue Ocean, right? So I'm just playing while, you know, Todd's working on the other side of the rig. Okay, so this is all right. So, and it's the reason why my computer was closed is because it was really windy. So I don't know why. I've got my headset on with the cables and stuff, but I left my lanyard on. Got the big, you know, like cruise to the edge, you know, thing. Uh-huh. And so we start playing, and the boat's rocking, and the audience, yay, and everything. And then the wind starts whipping the plastic thing while I'm singing. Like, with the wheel of emotion, the thing starts going boom and hitting me in the eye. It's the wind starts hitting me in the eye. The plastic thing. And so I'm like, oh my God, I got to try to get this thing off. And I don't know. I think I was wearing glasses. I don't know. But so I try to get the lanyard off. And this is like, now we're in the chorus.
Tied up in your micro cable, right?
And I'm trying to remember the chords and the words and everything at the same time.
Oh yeah,
yeah. It gets all wrapped up with my microphone, and it's like I'm trying to get it off, and I can't get it off. And then I'm like, Todd. So Todd comes back up, and he tries to get it off. He can't manage to get it off, so he just kind of tucks it into my pants or something, and then he leaves. Now we're on the second verse. Now we're like on the second verse or second chorus, even. Like, now we're, you know, this is all going on while you're trying to like be with the audience, be with the band, and remember what song you're playing, you know? And then I feel the plastic thing like sliding down my leg. It's now coming out of my shorts. Now it's dangling and banging on my leg. Really, it's super distracting. Now we're at the middle of the song, you know, Blue Ocean, take away. I'm like, Todd!
Not only did he have to cram something down your pants, now he's got to pull it out from your pants. That's a friend.
Well, he can't get it. He can't get that thing off. He finds some wire cutters. He finally just cuts the lanyard thing. He just cuts the whole thing off of me and gets it out of there. And then the other keyboard was working, and we went on with the show.
Yeah, but that was one of the
funniest.
The wind has been a big part of a lot of cruise moments, but that just, when you said that flap into your face, it just totally brought to mind, like, when we were in kindergarten, they used to like pin your homework to your shirt so you wouldn't forget to bring it home, and it'd be like walking home, and it's just like flapping in your face too. But anyway,
yeah, I don't know why that never happened to me, man. That doesn't really happen, man.
So anyway, yeah, that's funny.
I just thought I'd kill what you said just because I thought it was a funny thing to do.
Well, Well, I just think that at your age, you probably don't remember it, but
yeah, well, there you go. There you go. So what, so what's next, man? What's next?
What's next for me? I mean, we're, so Pattern Seeking is making their third album.
Oh, cool.
Right now, when Jimmy just finished drums on the last four tracks, and, so I've got stems and I've got vocals to do. We're on pace to have it done and mixed by September, and then the 6 month process begins because of good old vinyl. And
right.
So should be out, you know, should be out sometime in the next 5 years or so. So, but, no, I think we're aiming on having it out before the cruise, hopefully.
Oh, good.
Be nice to have at least three albums for sale that won't sell. You know, but the variety's there and that's important. I think it's been received really well. It's just so weird. You know, you own your own label, you run your own label, so you're probably acutely aware of your sales. But for the rest of us, I have no idea. I don't know until we're past the break-even point, you know, I have no idea how it's going. I think it's going well. It's been well received, like, critically.
Yeah, I noticed that.
But that's, you know, that's, I don't know if that's really a measure anymore, because I don't know how many of those critics are, and I probably shouldn't be saying this. I should put casting doubt on the positive reviews on an album that I'm supposed to be promoting.
But, Ted Leonard, ladies and gentlemen.
There you go. Brought to you, but yeah, I mean, it's just like, I think some of those guys are good friends with the label. You know, they've known Thomas for years. Here, review this one. And you know what I mean? I wonder, but you know,
I don't
know. Sincere.
I don't know, really. You know, I don't really keep track of sales either. Every once in a while, even when I have my own distribution, every once in a while, I would ask the parent company. I had my finger on more on the pulse then, because I was paying for manufacturing. So if we needed more, I had to actually pay for it. So that wakes you up a little bit. But
that's a good call to get. You need more.
Yeah, but that was also a bummer. If you know, it was the big challenge was to order. You know, you'd order a little more print. You know,
get a discount. Right?
But then sometimes you'd wind up. You know, they ship back to you like, you know, 6,000 units because you over ordered. Or then if you sell out of everything and you need more to do the print, just do 1,000 print is like, you know, super expensive. Whereas right. if you had ordered 1,000 more, it would have cost you $10 at the time that you ordered. Right. So the ordering part was like always like yikes. And then as the music business began to change, you know, it was, then it became, you couldn't really go off what you sold on the last record 3 years ago,
right.
You know, and it, you so know. It's quite the challenge. So now really, Radiant is mainly, online outlet, for all things, you know, even, tickets and VIP tickets and records and all kinds of things. But it's really, I don't have distribution anymore. So I'm not really dealing with the record company side of things very much, which is great. Yeah.
Yeah. It's one less thing to worry about for sure.
Yeah.
I have such a stockpile of just about every album I've ever been a part of. You know, luckily when we moved in a trailer, not in a trailer because I was driving, but,
I figured that out all by myself, Ted.
Yeah, we hauled a big trailer behind us, and so we left a lot behind because my stepson was going to take over the house that we were renting there and we bought here.
Oh, great. And,
yeah, so we left a bunch of stuff. That poor guy, he's got a huge stockpile of CDs that are just aging in my garage, you know?
Yeah, if I was a little more mobile, I'd take you into my, you could go see, my garage is like packed.
You probably need just a separate storage unit at this point just for that. Right?
Well, I had one, but it was, you know, to have a temperature controlled storage unit was, you know, not worth the CDs that we were selling of the stock, right. Really. Right. So at one point I was like, man, let's do whatever we can to get it all here. So we did that, but I'm hoping to bring a bunch of this stuff to Morse Fest, to both Morse Fests that are coming up. And hopefully we'll sell a bunch of stuff there. We hope. Maybe you can bring a bunch of your stuff, Ted.
Yeah. Well, now I have to send for it because it's in California.
Oh, yeah. But, yeah. There so, is that.
Yeah, I know. I always forget to bring, like, I had that solo album back in 2007, and I could have brought that the last couple times. The coolest shirt I have was a shirt at the 20th anniversary Morse Fest, you know, the one where we did, you know, the big, all the members of Spock's.
Yeah.
And it's got the voices of Spock's on it. I don't know if you got one of those. I don't remember who printed it, but it's got like the little silhouette of Yumi and Nick.
Yeah. Voices of the Beard, it was called. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There you go. Yeah. It was pretty cool. Yeah. Like, I have that shirt. I wear it with pride.
Ah, well, that's awesome. That was a great night. That whole thing.
That song, Falling. I always confuse it with Falling Into Fire or Into Fire.
Into
Falling for Forever.
Into Fire. Yeah, Falling for Forever.
You did this to me.
Yeah.
That is, by the way, the best Spock. If you don't know this part of the Spock Spirit catalog, now where was that? Was like a B-sides of Beware of Darkness or something like that? Some sort of Japanese release?
Oh, Into Fire? Yeah. No, I think it was later. It might have been for Day for Night, I think.
Okay.
Maybe.
So if you haven't heard it, Neal does like basically a Ronnie James Dio impression. And Into Fire! It was awesome. That's like my favorite Spock Spirit song.
Well,
that and when Dave Maros sings Iron Man, there's a B-sides on one of, I think it was on Oblivion Particle, you know, or something, one of those. Where,
oh, really? I haven't heard that.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Because, you know, Dave loves to sing. He's so prideful about it. He's like, yes. Give me more parts.
Right.
No, he's...
Yeah, he's always trying to get out of it.
The funny thing is, he can. He's got good pitch, you know.
Yeah.
When I have to mix things, you know, live things, and Dave has good pitch. He's a good singer.
Yeah.
He doesn't have a good sounding voice. He'll tell you this too. It's like he's got this weird covered tone, but it's like it blends well, and his pitch is good. So.
Yeah, we gave him and he sounded great on it. We gave him that upper part.
Right.
When we did the Yeah Yeahs in June, he does the June thing, and he sounded really good on that. Yeah.
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 So he does Iron Man. And,
well, how that heavy metal song came about, if you don't know, was when we first started Spock's, we were on a tiny, tiny label that a guy named Greg Walker ran out of his garage, but I don't remember how it happened now, but we wound up getting a major label deal with a company in Japan, and I think the label was called JVC, and it was considered to be a major at that time. So we were like, man, well, I guess we're just going to take off in Japan, and who knows, you know, I guess we'll be small in the rest of the world. And nothing ever really happened. They sold very few of our records, that company. And we licensed our records to them until the fifth album or something like that. But at the end of almost every album, I would get a fax, because it was before email. I would get a fax that said, nice album. Where is Heavy Metal Song?
That's awesome.
Where is Heavy Metal Song, you know? And so we would joke about that. And then somebody had asked us, maybe it was them, asked us to do, you know, bonus tracks for, you know, Day for Night, I think it was. And so Rio brought in what would become Into Fire. And we had the best time. If you ever get a chance to ask Dave Maros about that, I think he still says... That was, I mean, we were cry laughing as we wrote the lyrics together. And one of the moments I remember was like, let's see, bathed in blood, but we need another word, bathed in blood, bathed in what kind of blood, you know, foul blood, bathed in, and I think Dave said, tainted.
Bathed in tainted blood.
Bathed in tainted blood as the death count grows higher.
Oh my gosh. The funny thing is, like, if Ronnie James Dio had heard that, he'd be like, those are pretty clever lyrics. I should have thought of that. You know, no, it's his lyrics.
It was perfect. Really. Tainted blood. Blood wasn't bad enough to be bathed in.
I don't remember the line that precedes, you did this to me, but it makes it funny. It just, what you did to me, or something like that.
Yeah. Well, actually, I have a confession to make. Some friends of mine did a heavy metal parody for their like senior talent show in high school. And people remember what you see because what you did this to me.
Right.
was from them. I actually didn't make that. I totally stole that from their like senior talent show. People remember what you see, cause what you did this to me.
That was awesome. So now everybody's got to go find that, because that is. It's still my favorite spot.
I love the ambiguity of did this.
Like, did what?
What?
Like, I've got his hand missing from here down or something. Right. Did this to me.
It's just sort of obvious that whoever is singing that has to be completely insane. You know,
he's got to have like a gargoyle face or something.
Right? Yeah. Totally. Totally. Well, man.
We covered some really important stuff.
We did. We got heavy metal Walmart parody. The main thing is that you're. I'm so glad you're going to be coming out with us in Transatlantic, man.
It's going to be so much fun. I really enjoyed the last one, and I can't believe it was 7 years ago. It doesn't seem like, you know, Kaleidoscope. Just, I don't know what happened in the last 7 years, but yeah, it just flew by. I miss that sweatshirt. I still like the zip down Kaleidoscope sweatshirt. I saw a picture of myself in that a couple days ago. I'm like, what happened to that thing? I lost it somewhere. I think I lost it on the cruise, but anyway. But yeah, I mean, I had so much fun the last time, and what's even cooler, and I'm sure Michael's already thinking about this, but you know, the fact that Daniel's going to be on the cruise too with Pain of Salvation.
Oh, is he? I didn't know that.
Yeah. Well, they're listed.
Oh, okay. You know,
so I'm sure Mike's already, you know, Mike's always four steps ahead in, you know,
yeah,
in planning and stuff. So he's probably already thinking about that, getting Daniel up to do something.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
Cool.
Yeah, I'm really excited about doing the latest record, but I might be just as excited about Morsefest doing Whirlwind with strings and stuff. I mean, wow, that'll be so cool. And it'll be so cool to hear, like, you know, some of the orchestral stuff that's on the record actually, you know, played by real players, man. It's gonna be just amazing.
Is it gonna be some of the same players as the like the Jesus crew?
Some of them, you know, I usually just, you know, get like you know, the section leader guy, basically. I'll hire him, and then he puts the team together. But a lot of times, you know, sometimes it's, you know, one of the same and then other people, but they're always good. So, and we'll have you, Ted.
I'll be looking forward to that huge long list of songs that you've forewarned me about.
Yeah,
do you guys
know. It'll be.
Are you guys still kind of wait, letting the new album saturate to see which ones feel like they're going to be translating to live? Or are you planning on just doing the whole thing or something?
I cannot say. I cannot say. I really kind of give, most people know this, I give a lot of leeway to Mike for the set list. He's really good at it. I used to,
right.
I remember looking at many of his set list ideas going, oh my God. You know, a lot of times I thought it was too long, or, you know, I didn't see it. And then we'd do it and I would go like, oh yeah, yeah, he was right. He's really gifted with that, so. We'll let the gifts work, Ted.
I guess we'll see.
Yeah, you'll be hearing from us.
If I'm more than 9 days' notice this time, that'll be better.
Yeah,
because that was the other part about the last tours that people probably don't know, is that Daniel had some health complications, and you called me with 90s to go. And I went, yeah, that sounds great. And then you sent me the music. And I'm like, no, that sounds not great. I don't know if I can pull this off in 9 days. And then I just didn't sleep for 9 days. And it all worked out.
Yeah, well, you did great, man. You did great. Yeah, no, we'll have plenty of time. I probably won't start working on this, you know, till the beginning of the new year, probably. But we'll get you the music and it'll be great. Yeah,
it'll be cool. I just need to get my my keyboard chops going again, because, you know, between tours, and I don't write from a keyboard very often. Sometimes I'll do it just because I'm getting bored of what I'm coming up with on guitar, you know?
Yeah.
But a lot of times I have an easier time just writing with an acoustic, or writing something riff based from electric, you know?
Yeah.
Or even starting with the drum pattern, the last thing I go to is the keyboard.
Well, I'll make sure I challenge you.
Yeah. So
since
the last tour,
I'll make sure that I give you the most difficult keyboard parts. No, I won't. I won't do that. Yeah, man. Well, good talking with you, Ted. Musicians having coffee. Did you have coffee? You had coffee. You had the cup.
I did have coffee in my Hallmark mug.
And we talked about stuff.
We indeed did talk about stuff.
From Hallmark music to Hallmark movies to guitars to Transatlantic. All right, brother. Hey, man, I'm happy for you being out in this new environment. And I think that sounds really good. It sounds like good things are happening for you.
Yeah, it's been really cool. Love it. I mean, I didn't expect to love it. I mean, everybody was like, hey, you're moving to New York. I'm like, yeah, you know, but I really do. I mean, it's beautiful here. Of course, I haven't suffered through a winter yet.
Right.
We'll see.
We'll let you know. Yeah. We'll talk to you in April and see how.
Yeah.
But at least you won't be like burning, you know, literally burning up in California.
That's true. I'm not going to catch on fire. I'm not going to be into fire. There's no drought, that's for sure. Gosh, man, it's like this has been the wettest summer in a long time. I don't know what it's been like in Nashville, but it's been really rainy here. So
Interesting.
Rain is still a novelty for me. Everybody's like, yeah, the rain. I'm like, this is awesome. What are you talking about? But I'm sure like a year from now, I'm like, yeah, the rain, you know, I'll be just hating it like everybody else. But it's amazing. The outside my window, because it backs up to open space, is like a little nature show. It's just so many animals, little furry creatures just running by, chipmunks and squirrels. And I feel like Snow White. They're all just like gathering around me. So there's butterflies and birds that I've never seen before, you know, that you're like, what the heck is that?
So you just put your arms out and they all like come to you as you're singing. Yeah.
With way too fast of vibrato.
As you're singing, into fire!
Into fire! it's crazy. It's a nature show. It's pretty cool.
That's cool, man. Good. All right, my brother. Well, we'll be talking and we'll be playing.
Yes, indeed.
It's going to be good.
It will probably come upon us very, very soon if the last 7 years is any indication of how fast time goes.
Came upon us much too soon.
I've heard that one.
Hey. Wait, what?
Is that again?
All right, my friend. Take care, bro.
All right, thank you. It was fun chatting.
Yeah.
Always good.
Good
always
stuff.
Good to talk.
Yeah. See you later, Ted. The painting goes on.